try to discuss primary nutrients, nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. So we have seen major roles. What are the roles being played by these NPK in plant system? And then we have seen the deficiency symptoms. What happens when we have short supply of these nutrients in soil? So we've seen that most of the deficiency symptoms come on lower leaves, as these are mobile nutrients, NPK. And we have seen the occurrence of deficiency of NPK. What are the conditions or soil conditions where we find nitrogen, phosphorus, potash deficiency? And we have seen causes, the reasons for such deficiencies. And finally, the corrective measures. Measures for nitrogen, phosphorus, potassium, some are common and some are different. So for example, different means in case of nitrogen management, you have legumes that fix nitrogen, but phosphorus and potassium is not fixed by the plants. So therefore, some differences in management are there. But in all the three cases, we also go for fertilizer application, organic matter addition, and in sometimes it can be foliar application. And also we can use certain biofertilizer for the management of NPK. Today we are going to discuss secondary plant nutrients, calcium, magnesium, sulfur, and three micronutrients. So because it is not possible to cover all the micronutrients in one lecture, therefore, we have divided them into two lectures. So today we will discuss calcium, magnesium, sulfur, and iron, manganese, boron. So overall learning objective is to see the deficiency symptoms and their role and corrective measures, how we can correct if we get deficiency of secondary nutrients and iron, manganese, and boron. Some terminology, you can see rock. Most of you know what do we mean by rock. The material that forms the essential part of the earth's solid crust, including loose incoherent masses such as sand and gravel, as well as solid masses of granite and limestone. Mottling. Many times you must have listened symptoms like mottling. So mottling means spots or blotches. These are blotches are also kind of spots of different color or shades of color. Interspersed means intermixed with the dominant color. So one will be dominant color and other will be tinges or small spots of another colors also. So such kind of symptom is your mottling of leaves. Many times we hear mottling of leaf, which is discoloration of leaves in spots. Other is rosetting. Many times you must have heard rosetting. So what is rosetting? R-O-S-S-E-T-T-I-N-G, something like this. So what is rosetting? Any idea?
Sir, bunch-like structure, small leaves clustered together.
Very good. So these leaves and tender parts appear in clusters because of the reduced size of the leaf. So size of the leaves reduces and they look like in a bunch. In less area, you get more number of leaves. So such kind of symptoms are rosetting of leaves. pH-dependent charge. So that portion of the total charge of the soil particles that is affected by and varies with the changes in pH. Means some charge is fixed in the soil, but if you change the pH, how much is the changes? How much are the changes in the charge? They are pH-dependent charges. Necrosis is death of tissues or death of plant parts. So death associated with discoloration and dehydration of all or parts of the plant organs, such as leaves, necrosis. Siderophores is a known porphyrin metabolite secreted by certain microorganisms that forms a highly stable coordination compound with iron. So siderophores are actually certain secretions or certain organic molecules or compounds which are released from the plant to take advantage. The plant wants something back by producing siderophores. So maybe it wants to take some iron. Plant needs some iron. So it will release siderophores, and those siderophores will complex the iron and help in the uptake of iron. So siderophores are important. They are simply organic molecules or chemicals. Protein, any of a group of nitrogen-containing organic compounds formed by the polymerization of a large number of amino acid molecules, and then upon hydrolysis yield these amino acids. Most of you must have seen the structure of proteins. So it is made up of amino acids. Root nodules, swollen growth on plant roots, often in reference to those with symbiotic microbes. Now, most of you know what are the different secondary nutrients, calcium, magnesium, and sulfur. And they are really important. Their name secondary means, it does not mean that they are next to nitrogen, phosphorus, potash. Actually, they are called secondary because people give emphasis on application of nitrogen, phosphorus, and potassium. And also their deficiency is widespread. So it is of prime importance or first importance to the farmer. Therefore, they are called as primary nutrients. But if soil is deficient in sulfur or calcium or magnesium, then you cannot get the benefit of primary nutrients. If you want benefit of primary nutrients, then secondary nutrients should also be there in the right proportion. I need not to mention or recall the law of minimum, which says, which talks about balanced fertilization. Now we take calcium, so it is availability is adequate. So actually calcium availability in most of the soils is sufficient, particularly neutral to alkaline soil. So under such condition, there is no need for application of any calcium. And it is mainly under acidic conditions or in acid soils where we have deficiency or shortage of calcium. Under those conditions, we are also in need of improving the pH if it is too acidic. So lime application or calcium application is required only in acidic soils. So deficiency occurs mainly in acid or sandy soils, which available calcium has been leached down. From sandy soil, the leaching can happen, and soil development, if you remember how these acid soils develop in high rainfall areas, then you will find that some cations are leached down, calcium, magnesium leaching is there, and soils become acidic. So in acid soil and in sandy soils, you get deficiency of calcium. High exchangeable sodium may depress plant uptake. Under certain soils, if you have higher levels of sodium, calcium may be there, but there is competition for uptake, then sodium will suppress uptake of calcium. So actually this sodium, potassium, calcium, of course, sodium is not an essential nutrient, but it is very much there in the soil, in neutral to alkaline soils. So the sodium, potassium, calcium, and magnesium, they have very strong competition with each other. So the iron or cation, which is in more amount, which is in more quantity available in the soil, will suppress the uptake of other. Suppose in certain soils, you get excess of potassium, too much of potassium is there. So calcium is also there. So it will not allow calcium to be taken by plant. So they will compete with each other. So that is why in this trimester, we have one seminar on substitution of potassium by sodium or something, some title like that. So they got some competition. So high exchangeable sodium may depress plant uptake of calcium. Coming to the role or function of calcium in plants, so it ranks with magnesium, phosphorus, and sulfur in the group of least abundant macronutrients in plants. So they are macronutrients, these magnesium, potassium, phosphorus, and sodium. So they are in least concentration, least amount in the plant system, and almost similar amounts also is phosphorus, sulfur, and your magnesium. They are in similar quantity also in the plant. Concentration, of course, some variations are there, but they are relatively close. It is absorbed as Ca2+ cation, divalent cation. Calcium is a part of the architecture of cell wall. Yesterday we discussed calcium pectate is there, one compound is there, which is in cell wall. It is necessary for cell division, growth, and root lengthening. This is the most important function of calcium. It helps in the lengthening of the roots and activation or inhibition of certain enzymes. And of course, it is immobile in the phloem. So if it is immobile in the plant system, then definitely this deficiency symptom will come on younger leaves or the new tissues of the plant or top of the plant. So it's deficiency. These are very general symptoms of calcium deficiency, reduced growth, death of growing tips, and blossom and rot of tomato, poor fruit development and appearance. So actually this blossom means flower or fruit. Oh, sorry, flower. Blossom means flower, and blossom also means bloom, blooming, BLOOM, bloom, blossom, flowering. They are equivalent word, almost equivalent word with respect to flowering in the plants. So, but it is a fruit. So why do we call it blossom and rot? Blossom, because blossom means flower. So why sir, we call it, yeah.
Sir, it is known as the, in the tomato fruit, it is known as the blossom end, the lowermost end of the fruit. It is blossom end. And the rot in that area is known as blossom and rot.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely correct. Absolutely correct. The part of the tomato, the tip of the tomato where this disease or this disorder comes is also known as blossom. And that is the end of the fruit. Therefore, it is blossom and rot. So you are very much right. So therefore, I was also thinking blossom means flower, but blossom means also actually part of the fruit. The last part, the end part where it ends, the lower part of the fruit. So poor fruit development and appearance. So deficiency symptoms, they were general symptoms. Now specific deficiency symptoms seen first on growing tips and youngest leaves. This is applicable to all immobile nutrients, no doubt about it. And leaves become small, distorted, cup-shaped, crinkled and dark green. They cease growing and become disorganized, twisted. Twisting of leaves is there, and under severe deficiency, death of the leaves may also be there. So calcium deficiency may lead to death of the growing points. So groundnut shells may become hollow or poorly filled. The fruit of the groundnut, you know, it can remain hollow. So calcium is very, very important for groundnut. You can see deficiency symptom in maize on the left side. So the first picture shows that leaves are twisted and they are attached to each other. Leaves are attached to each other. Their apex part, their tips are attached to each other. And see the middle picture where the death of the growing region is shown. And see the third picture where twisting of leaves happen. So this is blossom and rot of tomatoes. So you can see this picture. Now see in banana on the left side, calcium deficiency symptoms in the growing region, twisting of leaves. On the right side, you see apple. This is discoloration of apple due to calcium deficiency. And see the case in maize again. You can see on the right side, there is some ladder-like structure. So this is very typical deficiency symptom of calcium. Tip ends of leaves glued together. They are attached together. You can see in these pictures. So ladder-like appearance. It is quite unique deficiency symptom of calcium in cereal crops, particularly maize, pulp millet, and sorghum, and also in sugarcane. So you can see this is in pulp millet. Pulminate twisting of leaves and the attachment of leaves, the tips are glued to each other. And this is in sugarcane, the same kind of deficiency symptoms. Young leaves remain rolled and joined together at their tips, and ladder-like appearance, and then hooking of leaves. Now, what happens when we have calcium in excess? So excess calcium may cause deficiency in either magnesium or potassium. In general, it is very general principle. The iron or cation or anion, which is present in large amount, more available, it will suppress other. For example, Pehelwan, you know, Pehelwan or wrestler. wrestler is very strong. So a small wrestler or minor wrestler, he can easily defeat those. So similarly, in the soil, if you have very strong concentration of one nutrient, it will suppress other. So areas affected by deficiency are mostly acidic soils, and option in this case is correction of soil pH. Magnesium, you know, occupies the central spot in chlorophyll. It is in the structure of the chlorophyll, and the main job is activation of enzymes, energy transfer, and maintenance of electrical balance in the plant. It is also necessary for the production of proteins, metabolism of carbohydrate, and it is mobile within the plants. It is mobile within the plant, that means deficiency will come on lower leaves or older leaves. Deficiency symptoms of magnesium readily translocated. So deficiency symptoms appear on older parts. Interveinal chlorosis is a typical symptom that happens on older leaves in which the veins remain green, but the area between them turns yellow. Poor food development and production. You can see these pictures on the right side. Interveinal chlorosis on midrib section of the leaf. Means area around the midrib you can see, and then this color or discoloration deepens. It deepens further. Interveinal chlorosis covers the entire leaf. Necrosis in interveinal area of the leaf. Necrosis is there. You can see magnesium deficiency symptoms in legumes like this. This may be mung bean. It may be mung bean. Stunted plant showing severely deficient bottom leaves. You can see the deficiency symptoms are on mainly on the lower leaves, and upper leaves are green and veins are also green. This is in cotton, a magnesium deficient plant showing reddening of lower leaves. So now you can see this reddening of lower leaves. Many times people will confuse it with the deficiency of phosphorus. In deficiency of phosphorus also, we get accumulation of some pigments on the leaves. So it becomes very difficult to make a distinction between deficiency symptom of phosphorus and magnesium in case of cotton. You see this further advancing, this reddening is further advancing in the deficiency of magnesium. So see the first picture, reddening of leaf margins advancing into interveinal areas. Still, veins are green, but you can see it is advancing towards it. Reddening intensified. And next time, with the advancement of deficiency symptom, into interveinal tissues while veins look prominent and green. And last picture, reddening turns into brown necrosis. Now, the death of the tissues can happen in interveinal areas. So once the death has occurred, such tissues cannot recover back if you supply magnesium to them. Excess magnesium high concentration is tolerated by plant up to some level. However, imbalance with calcium and potassium may reduce the growth because the other will not be there in sufficient quantity. It will suppress uptake of potassium and calcium. Now, sulfur, the third important secondary nutrient is sulfur. And it is becoming more and more limiting in crop production situation. We observe deficiency of sulfur in many areas of the country. I have shown you some data on this sulfur deficiency. So higher crop yields require more sulfur. It is removed as much as your phosphorus. So you need some more. And also sulfur is very liable to be leached down. Leaching can happen. Sulfate leaching can happen. So also other reason for deficiency is that people are using high analysis fertilizer, urea, NPK, or some other fertilizers, DAP. They are not using fertilizer which used to contain sulfur, like single superphosphate used to contain sulfur, and ammonium sulfate used to have sulfur also. So reduce amount of atmospheric sulfur fallout from the sky. This is another reason. Now we are not getting sulfur deposition from the atmosphere. Reduce soil sulfur reserve from the organic matter. Many times some part of the sulfur is there in organic forms. Certain proteins contain your sulfur. So if your organic matter is decreasing or declining, so sulfur level, phosphorus level, nitrogen level, they will also decline. More sulfur in the soil is tied up in organic matter and cannot be used by plant until it is converted to the sulfate. So also, if you have short of sulfur in the soil, if it has come to from organic matter, then the decomposition of organic matter is not that fast to meet the requirement of plants for sulfur. Now, role of sulfur in plants. What are the functions of sulfur? So it is part of certain amino acids like cysteine, cysteine, and methionine. Formation of chlorophyll and activation of enzyme. This is very important role of sulfur. That is why chlorosis happens. Chlorosis means loss of chlorophyll, loss of green color. So formation of, it is necessary for formation of chlorophyll and activation of enzymes. Part of vitamin, biotin, and thiamine. In most plants, the concentration is 0.2 to 0.3% of the dry matter. And needed for formation of mustard oil, sulfur drill linkages that are the source of pungency in onion and oils, etc. So it is necessary for oil production also. In especially, it has got some value in oilseed crops, required by crops in amounts comparable with phosphorus. Deficiency of sulfur, initial yellowing of young leaves, is spreading to whole plant. Similar symptom of nitrogen deficiency, but occur on new growth. So there is uniform chlorosis of the plant, but in this case, upper leaves chlorosis is there. In nitrogen, lower leaves chlorosis is there. Deficiency symptoms on young leaves first. So deficiency symptom come on young tissues, and it resembles that of nitrogen. The difference is that it comes on younger leaves. Plants are small with short and slender stalks. Growth is retarded and maturity in cereal is delayed. You can see this picture, sulfur deficiency symptoms on younger leaves. This is in black gram. You can see lower leaves are okay. The lower leaves are green, but younger leaves are turning yellow. This is in groundnut. You can see deficiency symptom of sulfur. These oil seeds are very sensitive to sulfur deficiency. So again, in cotton, you can see uniform chlorosis of young leaves. So what are the areas that are affected by deficiency of sulfur? So light texture soils with low organic matter. In light texture soils, leaching is more, and also levels of organic matter are low. Therefore, the sulfur availability in such soil is low. In canal irrigated areas, you get shallow water table, and there may be some leaching of sulfur. And basically, these soils contain more of generally higher pH is there under these conditions. Areas with sulfur-free fertilizers are used. Acid soils. Acid soils. Can you see my presentation?
No, sir.
So where has it gone? Where has it gone? I'll share again. Okay. I will share. Were you able to listen what I was speaking?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so there was some internet disconnection of the
yes,
internet.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So areas affected by deficiency are light texture soils and areas where sulfur-free fertilizers are used, acid soils, and wheat is more prone to sulfur deficiency than rice. So if we in system basis, if we see, so wheat needs more sulfur than rice or application of sulfur. General recommendation is that you can apply gypsum at the rate of 120 to 150 kg per hectare to soil, followed by mixing and a light irrigation. But it needs to be applied in advance in at least 10 to 15 days before the crop sowing. And this is very general recommendation. Of course, it will depend upon the pH. In cases where sulfur deficiency is there and farmers want to apply and they do not have any soil test, Under those conditions, this is very general recommendation, 125 to 150 kg per hectare gypsum. And here I want to tell you that gypsum contains about 16% or 16 to 18%, I think. How much it contains sulfur? Sulfur content in gypsum?
Yes, sir, 16 to 18%.
Yeah, roughly it contains 16 to 18% sulfur, and it is the cheapest source of sulfur. It is the cheapest source of sulfur compared to elemental sulfur or other forms of sulfur. If you want to apply through zinc sulfate or any sulfate fertilizer, it comes out to be very expensive. But gypsum is the cheapest source of sulfur. Now, after secondary nutrients, we come to iron, the minor nutrients or micronutrients. It is necessary for synthesis of chlorophyll, carbohydrate production, cell respiration, chemical reduction of nitrate and sulfate, and in nitrogen assimilation. So it has many important roles in plants. And this is important for students. You should read it. So it may be useful to you sometimes in quiz exam or interviews. People may ask that what is catalase, what is peroxidase, lag hemoglobin, ferredoxin, so on. So you can go through this table later. Here the structure, some enzymes and other proteins in which iron functions in a plant metabolism. So it has very important role in enzyme activation, or it may be part of enzymes and so on. So see, the first column is protein. For example, catalase. Structure is heme, and it catalyzes the decomposition of hydrogen peroxide to water and oxygen. So this is the role of iron here. Another role you can see in peroxidases, heme, a family of enzymes that metabolize reactive oxygen species, including organic peroxides or hydrogen peroxide to water and oxygen. So this role is important, role of iron is important. You can go through it. Now, iron deficiency, initial distinct yellow or white areas. So the difference in sulfur and iron deficiency is mainly in color. In both the cases, deficiency comes on the young leaves or new leaves. In both the cases, there is uniform chlorosis. The only difference is that in case of iron deficiency, immediately the plant will convert, the leaf part will convert to white. That is the difference. In sulfur, it is not so. That will go or become further yellow or pale color. So in this case, initial distinct yellow or white areas between veins of young leaves leading to spots of dead leaf tissue. So in the end, you will get dead leaf tissues. In severe deficiency, the young leaves turn entirely white. So this is typical deficiency symptoms of iron. Iron excess, what can it do? Possible bronzing of leaves with tiny brown spots. So iron excess is also dangerous. Iron toxicity is a problem in cereal crops. In rice, I discussed it in one course on cereal crops. Those who attended it might may recall that we got certain conditions where you get iron excess also, which is toxic. Aluminium toxicity, iron toxicity in acidic soils, particularly in rice, is a common problem in many East Asian countries. And in India, it is in Assam. Iron uptake by plants. So uptake is a problem because rice or many plants like to take up iron in ferrous form. Ferrous form is reduced form. And ferric form is oxidized form. So under rice conditions, where you get soils flooded, anaerobic conditions, or where there is no oxygen, under those conditions, iron automatically reduces to a ferrous form. And rice is happy to take up ferrous form. And if it is too much, then it will be iron toxicity. Otherwise, there will not be deficiency of iron under anaerobic conditions, because soil contains about 5 to 6% iron by weight. There is no shortage of iron in the soil. It is just question of availability of the iron. So for example, wheat. So wheat is grown under aerobic conditions, under mesophytic conditions, where there is not too much of water or too short of water. Conditions are partly or say half, 50% aerobic, you can say, or kind of aerobic situation in maize or in wheat or in many other crops. So now question comes, under aerobic conditions, under these conditions, the iron will be available in ferric form. So ferric form means Fe3+. So ferric cannot be taken up by the plant. For rice, okay, it was flooding, ferrous was there, rice has taken it. But rice can also be grown under upland conditions, aerobic conditions, direct seeded conditions. So under these aerobic conditions, what are the mechanism by which plant will take up iron? Because plant do not want to take up iron in ferric form. It likes to take up in ferrous form. Then how will it take it under aerobic conditions? So certain plants have developed mechanism to take up this ferric form of iron. And what are the mechanism? We will see two strategies of iron uptake by plant. One is plant reduce Fe3. So certain plants will have characteristics to reduce the Fe3 to Fe2. Means they will release certain compound into the soil, and those compounds or exudates will convert ferric into ferrous, and then the plant will take up. So this is one mechanism. So I read it, complexes. Plant can reduce the Fe3 to Fe2. So complexes at the root surface and absorb the Fe2 ions produced via this root associated reduction. So roots, the material from roots has reduced the oxidized iron Fe3 into Fe2. It includes, the examples are all dicots and the monocots not included in the poicy. Means all monocots minus poicy or gramini. In gramini, it is not possible to convert ferric into ferrous. But other plant like these dicots or other monocots, there may be some other monocots also, they follow this mechanism. The other is that plant excrete specific Fe3 binding material. Now this is second pathway, low molecular weight organic polydentate ligands known as phytosiderophore or simply siderophores are produced, which solubilize Fe3 in ions and make them available for absorption. Means they solubilize, they complex this Fe3. They complex it, they take it into themselves. They complex it, and with this, they are taken up back by the plant. So these are the two mechanisms of iron uptake. For more details, you can see any plant physiology book where these kind of things are explained. Now see, iron deficiency in rice, deficiency is mainly problem in upland soils, because rice has no mechanism to convert this Fe3 to Fe2, or even the second one is also not available. Very small quantity by pathway 2 is taken up by rice. So rice suffers severely under aerobic conditions, this iron deficiency. So this is in maize, this is in groundnut, you can see very quite contrasting. And in soybean also, iron deficiency is quite common in soybean. Whenever soybean is grown, if you see that younger leaves are yellow, you will feel that this is iron deficiency, quite common. If you visit these soybean fields, you will find potato. Now in potato also, iron deficiency is seen. So just you see, if younger leaves are yellow, you may consider it as iron deficiency, because certain crops are very sensitive to iron deficiency. So the soybean particularly is very sensitive to iron deficiency. See this rice, direct seeded rice, iron deficiency, lower leaves are somewhat green. And you see white color is seen in this case, white color of the leaves. If you see it critically, initially from green, it will become yellow, and from yellow, it will become white, and from white, it will dry and it will become brown. So these are the color changes in iron deficiency. So this is a nursery. You can see the area of the nursery where water is not staying. is yellow and the lower end you will see that plants are green. It is because the water is, more water is there on the lower end. On the upper area, water is not staying here. So therefore, it is water dependent. If you create reduced condition, iron deficiency will never be there. But if you have oxidized condition, aerobic conditions, then iron deficiency will be there. So this, you see, this is advanced stage of iron deficiency symptoms in rice. This is in direct seeded rice, iron deficiency symptoms. The area of the field where water stands or water stays are green, and other area where water is not staying are yellow. So even in transplanted rice, you can experience iron deficiency. This is transplanted rice with iron deficiency. So what are the areas that are affected by iron deficiency? Soils with coarse texture, high pH, calcium carbonate, and low organic matter. Most common in highly permeable coarse soils. So these coarse soils are really poorly fertile, very poorly fertile. Soils irrigated with sodic water, soils with high accumulation of heavy metals inhibit uptake and translocation of iron. So these heavy metal compete with iron for uptake. Therefore, iron deficiency can be experienced by the plants. Reasons are highly permeable soil cannot pond water. Coarse structure soils, they cannot pond the water. Soils may not be deficient in iron, but it remains in unavailable form, ferric form. It is not reduced to ferrous form. Corrective measures ensure prolonged ponding of irrigation water. So you can keep your soil flooded only in cases when you have rice, but you cannot do same practice for other crops, for aerobic crops. So if applied to soil under oxidized condition or in alkaline soil, it gets converted to oxidized form or unavailable forms. So option is that one can go for foliar spray 0.5 to 2% of ferrous sulfate. So why this range is there, 0.5 to 2%? Why I did not write this straight away 2% or 1.5%? Because this concentration of application will vary with the plant variety, with the crops. One crop may tolerate higher concentration, other may tolerate lower concentration. Similarly, stage of the crop. If it is early stage, like seedling stage of any crop, and you find iron deficiency, then concentration can be 0.5%. And if it is ground growth phase where plant is growing very actively and it has attained some growth, some dry matter has been already attained by the plants. So in those cases, you can increase the concentration. For example, in the rice nursery, it is 0.2% foliar spray of iron sulfate recommended. But when plant, after transplanting, when it is 45 to 50 days crop, you can apply 2% iron sulfate. Because by that time, plant has accumulated large amount of dry matter and it demands also more iron and it can tolerate even some more quantity of fertilizer or more quantity of iron. Green manuring can be useful. Now we go to manganese. So after iron, any question on iron or sulfur or calcium or magnesium? Any point of discussion? Arul? Arul, are you there?
Hi.
Any question?
No, sir.
Okay. So now we switch to manganese. It is known to activate several enzymes. So iron, manganese, these kind of micronutrients, metallic micronutrients are four. Iron, manganese, zinc, copper. So these metallic micronutrients or cations have very important role in activation of enzymes, synthesis of certain compounds in plants. So it is essential for sprinting of water molecule during the photosynthesis. Manganese is also important in nitrogen metabolism and in CO2 assimilation, that is photosynthesis. Deficiency of manganese is intervenal yellowing or mottling of young leaves. Mottle means color with the streaks or blotches of different shades. Manganese excess older leaves have brown spots surrounded by a chlorotic circle or zone, crinkle leaf of cotton. So manganese excess can lead to toxicity. Excess of all the micronutrients will give you toxicity symptoms because their slight change in concentration or slight change in uptake will result in toxicity. This is manganese deficiency in maize, in potato. So what are the areas that are affected by manganese deficiency? Highly permeable core structure soil. They are always blamed for deficiency of nutrients. Highly permeable core structure soils continuously under rice weed system. So they may become deficient. These soils will become deficient in manganese. Alkaline soils. Reasons for the deficiency. Solubilization of manganese and its leaching to deeper layers. A continuous cultivation of rice for 6 to 7 years and depletion of manganese in surface layer. So depletion can happen under intensive cropping system. So one may experience the manganese deficiency. Now, how we can correct the manganese deficiency? You go for a foliar spray, like all the metallic elements, zinc, copper, manganese, and iron. You need to spray. Foliar spray of the nutrients is recommended, except in case of zinc. Generally, soil application is recommended. For iron, soil application is not recommended. In manganese, soil application not recommended. Iron, manganese, copper. There is no recommendation of soil application because if you want to do it, they will quickly convert to the unavailable form in the soil. This is one reason. Therefore, to get the response of soil application of manganese, iron, or copper, you need to apply very large quantities of these materials, of the sulfate. For example, iron sulfate. If you want to supply iron from soil and correct the iron deficiency, then you need at least 150 to 200 kilograms of iron sulfate per hectare. So very large quantity and micronutrient. It may be hardly one and one half kg per hectare uptake in cereal crops, not more than 2 kg uptake from 1 hectare, and you are applying 200 kilogram of iron sulfate. Too much of iron will go to your soil, but still it cannot correct your deficiency of iron. It has been observed because iron sulfate will quickly convert to a ferric form under aerobic conditions. Under anaerobic condition, no need to apply. Under aerobic condition, if you apply, it will be quickly converted to ferric form and made unavailable. So there is no fun in applying this iron through fertilizers, through iron sulfate, or applying manganese through your fertilizers, or zinc, of course. In case of zinc, it is applied or preferred through fertilizer application. Zinc sulfate is recommended, but for others, it is not recommended. Durum wheat are highly susceptible to manganese deficiency. Therefore, estimum wheat may be grown in manganese deficient areas. So this is one option, management option, that durum wheat are more sensitive to manganese deficiency. Boron is the third one after iron and manganese. So membrane integrity, it has role in membrane integrity and cell wall development, which affect permeability, cell division, and extension. Pollen tube, it is necessary for the germination of the pollen tube, which affects seed or food set. So particularly in seed crop, if you are taking your crops for seed production, then boron has very important role because it is involved in the germination of the pollen tube. Boron deficiency mostly in young part, growing points, and meristematic tissues, stem tips, root tips, and new leaves, and flower buds. Death of growing points is a typical symptom of boron deficiency and deformation of leaves and areas of discoloration. Excess boron, leaf tips become yellow, followed by necrosis. Leaves get a scorched appearance and later fall off. So these are the symptoms in boron deficiency in maize. You can see the the grain number has reduced and there is blackening of the grains. There is no proper filling of the grain. Proper filling of the grain, because it has role in the grain development or seed development. And if there is no germination of pollen tube, means fertilization will be incomplete. It will not be done. Therefore, some grains will not be there. And see in other crops like in cauliflower, you can see browning of the curd, browning or blackening of the curds. And in potato also, you can see black inside the tuber. You see these black spots of some rotting of the tuber. Rotting of the tuber has started due to boron deficiency. And in case of this looks to be sunflower. In sunflower, you can see bud leaves develop a bronze color, the first leaves, a crowded leaves at the top of a plant here in sunflower, and leaf margins cup downwards. So this sunflower crops responds very well to this boron application. And see in maize, puckering on affected leaves, some overgrowth, small overgrowth on the leaves. You can see in the picture number 1 and 2, puckering, some small thickening of the leaves, tightly gather or contact into wrinkles or small folds, transparent stripes on affected leaf. So coarse structure soils are affected by deficiency, or acid soils also, and boron toxicity is there in highly alkaline soils containing high content of free calcium carbonate and indiscriminate and regular application of boron fertilizer. So there is chance of toxicity also. Now, lastly, you need to remember certain points. Inadequate boron supply represent one of the economically most important micronutrient disorder worldwide. Under high rainfall conditions in sandy, heavily weathered, or acidic soils, boron can be leached easily, and boron deficiency severely limits the yield. On the other hand, under low rainfall conditions or in field dominated by alkaline or organic soils, boron often accumulates to levels that are toxic for the plants. Irrigation with high boron containing water. This is an issue, the quality of irrigation water, or without proper drainage also can increase topsoil boron levels and reduce crop yields. The window between insufficient and toxic boron levels can be quite small. This is important. Whenever we are using boron through soil or through foliar spray, we need to be very, very careful in giving the right quantity of this fertilizer. If there is a small change, if suppose I just assume it was 0.003% concentration, if you make it 0.03, so there will be 10 times increase in concentration. So it can affect severely the crop. It can give you toxicity. So the margin of error is very small. The window between the insufficient and toxic boron levels can be quite small. Plants respond to an inadequate boron supply with a large number of anatomical, physiological, and biochemical alterations, some of which may be secondary effects of growth inhibition. So it completes your secondary nutrients, calcium, magnesium, sulfur, and then micronutrient, iron, manganese, and boron. So I tried to complete, give you some overview of their role, their deficiency symptoms, and areas affected by, and some pictures. So it was just kind of introduction to these nutrients. Now what you need is studying these nutrients in detail. You need to study, for example, if it is iron, then you need to study iron in soil. What iron is doing in soil, how it is behaving, how it is cycling in soil. So that kind of study is required. Similarly for phosphorus, nitrogen, you need to study nitrogen in soil and then nitrogen in fertilizer. Similarly, potassium in soil and potassium in fertilizer. So I have tried to cover in plant. These were mostly related to plant. Now other parts are left, the related to soil and your fertilizer. So that part will be covered by individual instructors. For example, calcium in soil and calcium fertilizers. These are the aspects you need to study in this course. So if by chance, if you are not taught, then I have already given you two good books. So study yourself. Study yourself how phosphorus is behaving in soil, how this potassium is behaving in soil, means what proportion is available, how availability is made. It is made available to the plants. And what are the sources of fertilizer and how those fertilizers are manufactured and what are the reaction of these fertilizer in soil? How do they behave in soil? How they convert to the available form? So these part are still left and hope that this part will also be taught to you. Thank you very much. Pulomi, you can stop recording. Now I welcome your questions.